really appreciate your presence. It's wonderful to see so many familiar faces, and for those of you who haven't been here before, welcome to the show. We really appreciate it. I have this very important responsibility to talk about the industry every year, and this year I'm going to approach it from a slightly different angle. Those of you who have been here before know that I'm someone who loves to tell stories. I often like to call them real stories for obvious reasons. And to this end, I'm going to tell you a very true story today about foundations. I want to talk about foundations, both literal and digital this year, and how we build foundations for the future. And thinking about, as we are sort of moving into the next generation of DAM and the web, what can we do to build stronger foundations for that future? So this year, I'm going to tell a story about a man and his metadata. This is also a story of the American dream. This is Giuseppe Anthony Casaccio. You could look at him standing here and you might immediately get some ideas in your head of what he was like and maybe what his personality was. He was very classy, very sharp dresser, obviously, a man who knew how to invest in a good suit. Maybe he looks like someone who worked very hard, was very accomplished, had a nice car. Maybe you think he looks like a gangster, a little bit dangerous, a little bit devious, perhaps. This was his first American metadata on the right-hand side there. This metadata originated on the other side of the ocean, somewhere in the middle of the boot of Italy. We'll talk about this metadata in depth a little bit later, because it didn't quite get to America when it was supposed to. It took much longer than he would have liked. Giuseppe came from a small town called Riccia in the middle of Italy. It's in Abruzzi. If you drive out of Rome, you can get there in about 2 hours. It's a tiny little town, and it's a city of stone. It's a city built of stone houses. It's really a town. It's not much of a city. Very small place. And it was forged by the same sort of Italian stonemasons who built the great structures of the Colosseum and the like. Giuseppe used to climb up that clock tower, and he used to look out from that clock tower, and he used to dream of America, because that's where his father was most of the time. He loved the view from up there, and he thought about his father off in America, who was cutting stone. He was a stone worker. He went over to America to work for long periods of time, and he would come back to Riccia with his earnings and spend time with his family and bring some of his small fortune back. So Giuseppe used to dream of going to America with his father. And even though he went to school and he learned to read and write, he still actually preferred working with tactile things. He preferred cutting stone. And he really studied very, very closely the tools that were necessary to cut stone well and to lay foundations. He studied, in fact, the technology of stone cutting very, very closely. He was known from a young age for being very skilled with cutting the stone. Finally, when Giuseppe was a teenager, he made an effort to convince his mother to finally move to America. So here he is on the right-hand side with his two sisters and his mother getting ready to leave. It was 1914. Some of you probably know the significance of that date. So they packed everything they had into a trunk. It wasn't a very big trunk. It was made of wood and metal pieces. And when they went aboard the ship, they put their passports, which took them a very, very long time to acquire, as you might imagine in that day and age, took them a very long time to acquire the passports. They put the passports in the trunk, into this repository, and it went underneath the boat, into the cargo hold, and then they couldn't get on the ship. They put their documents in the wrong repository, and they ended up into the cargo hold of the ship, and they weren't allowed on the ship. It was the spring of 1914, and World War I broke out shortly thereafter. So they were stuck for 4 years. They couldn't actually get to America, and Giuseppe's father was still over in America, and so they had to stay apart for 4 long years. But because of the metadata that was on the side of the trunk, right down there, you might remember that label from the first slide, it still made its way all the way to Giuseppe's father. This was before the days of passenger baggage matching, so all those times when you're on the plane and they say, well, we have to take that bag off because that passenger didn't show up, this was a little different. There went the trunk, made its way all the way to Giuseppe's father. It was actually with him for 4 long years during World War I, And then finally, when he was able to ship it back, he shipped it back. That all happened thanks to the metadata. Finally, after World War I was over, they packed everything back up, and they put this label back on the trunk, and they finally got ready to go. Let's look at this metadata and examine it. What does it mean? La Veloce. La Veloce was a shipping line that came out of Naples. Navigazione Italiana a Vapore, so that's the fast-speed Italian shipping line that went across the ocean. Leaving for New York, manufactured by Hartsfield Solari and Co. I looked that up. It's actually a luggage manufacturer based in London that was started by an Italian. 24 Whitehall Street was the address of that particular manufacturer of this particular trunk. And he went over on the SS Dante Alighieri on December 1st, 1919, after World War I was over. And he was in steerage with his family. And that was his baggage number, 5307 out of Naples. There's the boat that he went over on. They arrived at Ellis Island, like many people at the time. And they were very, very happy to be reunited with the father. Giuseppe's father was down in the city of Philadelphia. He was cutting stone for some of the most significant buildings in the city. For those of you who have been to Philadelphia, you know that there's a lot of very large, magnificent stone buildings there, and many of the sidewalks and houses are built of stone and brick. One day, Giuseppe was working. He started his own construction business at this point, and he was working on an extension of a high school, a stone high school. Even though he was 32, he had his eye on this lovely 17-year-old girl. In those days, you didn't go talk to the girl. You went and found the family of the girl, right? So he went and found the parents of this lovely woman, and they soon fell in love. She was from New Jersey. Farmers, came from a farmer's family. And she loved Atlantic City. She loved the boardwalk. She loved to walk along the beach. And so she asked Giuseppe, would you build a foundation for our family? Would you build a foundation on the beach where I can be near my family and where I can be by the sea? So Giuseppe did a deal. He bought some land. There's the deed from the purchase. He, of course, knew a lot of people who owned land because he was always building structures. And then he built a blueprint. He came up with a strategy, a very, very specific strategy. He didn't just start building the house. He didn't just start buying the stone. He didn't just throw a lot of money at someone and tell them to build something without a plan. He didn't just buy something from somebody he knew. He had a very, very specific plan in place. He did a blueprint. This was Giuseppe's blueprint. He knew a few things. He had a limited land size, right? So he had to think about leaving some space because he knew that later he had to scale. He knew he wanted to have a lot of children. His wife wanted to have a lot of children. So he kept space on the land so that he could modularly add on to it and that he could grow the capacity of what he was building. This is something we often forget about in our industry. And it was really wonderful that Anne talked about sort of three different phases, three different stages of digital asset management. That was exactly what Giuseppe did with his house. He thought about building components. He thought about adding on to those components. His family very quickly grew, so he was building for them. And when he built, he also built with materials he understood. He wanted to build a house like in the old Italian style because he understood the materials, he understood the tools, he understood the technology that he was going to use. This story hits very close to my heart because this is what we do at Real Story Group. We help people pick tools, we help people pick materials, we help them understand what they need to use to build a strategy, to build a foundation. And that's what he was doing here. So when you look back at this, you can see that all of the specifications are very, very precise. What stone he was using, the exact dimensions, the number of plies in the wood, every single detail was planned before he bought anything, before he ever laid a stone to start. I would bet many people here have probably, unfortunately, either had to buy technology or install technology without going through this process, without having a firm blueprint and plan in place. And this is so important. It is, in fact, more important than what you end up using to build. Have it in place. Stone. He built with stone, he built it modularly, and he built it strong. He recognized, though, that there were threats. And that threat was the ocean. In fact, people started to talk about how the ocean was potentially a danger to the houses that were on this coastline. So when Giuseppe actually passed away in 1977, the Army Corps of Engineers about that time was talking about, how are we going to protect the beach? How are we going to deal with the onslaught, the rush of global warming, of the environment? Or we might say, in our industry, the onslaught of all the people coming onto the systems that we're using, right? And it was actually one of his daughters who became a structural engineer and an architect who had a conversation with the Army Corps of Engineers. And interestingly, many, many people in this town on the Jersey Shore did not want to build the dune because, of course, it was going to obstruct their view. It was going to kill the aesthetics. They didn't want to listen to the engineers. They wanted to ignore the engineers because it was going to obstruct their view. But fortunately, due to many generations of knowledge and accumulated understanding of the infrastructure, the issues, they built a dune. It might be a little bit hard to see here that there's a dune now there. It wasn't very much long after that that Sandy came. Now, I'm sure many of you might remember, many of you were probably here when Sandy hit. You saw what happened to the coastline, perhaps. The eye of Sandy hit two blocks south of the house that Giuseppe built. Storm went right over the house, basically. And it's interesting because many of you have probably seen the original homes along the Jersey Shore. Many of them were torn down and built up practically with perhaps not as strong materials. And many of those homes were destroyed. But Giuseppe's wall, dare I say it, along with the dune, had the scalability and even the elasticity to endure the onslaught of the storm. So the entire dune got washed away, but the wall stood strong. It was about architecture, it was about knowledge, it was about working with the engineers to understand what the potential issues were, the importance of planning, the importance of the strategy, and the importance of putting the right architecture, using the right tools, and laying the right foundation. So we, essentially, we're building houses of dam today, right? So think about, how do we architect for stability for the future? What do we have to do in order to protect against uncertainty as our systems get bigger, as they scale? What do we do to design for horizons rather than the now? This is our challenge, really, right now in dam, to design for the next 10 years, to let the future inform the present rather than the past. That's what Giuseppe did. How do we do that from a technical standpoint? How do we do that from a user experience standpoint? And think about, how do we lay a foundation today for the future? Let's talk a bit about that. Data. So I mentioned metadata at the beginning. That's the first thing. You have to think about your enterprise data foundation. You might not have seen this little strip of foundation that came up here, the enterprise data foundation. You probably have a whole bunch of repositories. Unfortunately, the first thing people tend to do is go buy something. Not necessarily the right thing to do. You have to make sure that your data is in order. Your foundation is strong. You have to get your foundation in place. And you have to think about, what is the data? How should it be organized? And how should it be structured in order to build a strong infrastructure above it in a modular way that informs what you need to do for your customer experience. DAM and MAM, of course, digital asset management and media asset management, that is our world. It is a foundational technology for everything we want to do with digital marketing, with branding, with product development. And that feeds into so many other systems that inform the digital experience. It feeds into web content management experiences. It feeds into mobile experiences. It feeds into how we want to communicate marketing, how we want to target, how we want to personalize. And of course, it feeds into social channels where we promote ourselves and where we promote our brands and where we engage with our customers. All of this is driving what we might call content and engagement management. But the foundation has to be the data and the dam that feeds into these things. These arrows are very deliberate, by the way. The colors of the arrows and where they feed to. So thinking about that purple arrow, the one single source of the truth, that foundational technology, the data and the assets feeding into these different technologies. You have to get those in line before you can work with the others. Then you're going to have a lot of other technologies that process things, that target things, that personalize things for our customers, right? We're building the layers of the house now. We're adding to it in a much more effective way, in a much more targeted way over time. You might have those assets feeding into an e-commerce system, tying into consumer analytics. So when you learn more about your consumer, you bring that back and then you adapt what you're doing. Just like you do in a house as your kids grow, right? You adapt the house, you need new materials, you need different kinds of toys, you need computers, right? It's the same sort of thing here. You adapt the materials and you grow and you change over time. And then it feeds into your channels. This is where it comes out. So thinking about the house of dam and the foundations that you have to lay at the beginning, start at the bottom, get your data in order, get your information in order, then make sure you have the appropriate systems and you layer on top of that, step by step. There's a lot more modern buildings that we could look to as well in terms of an analogy or a metaphor for what we do architecturally in DAM. So you need to build a framework with strong, durable, yet flexible standard materials. We have a lot of standards. There's that joke that we love standards because there's so many of them. But there are many that you can apply and yet be flexible with. And fortunately, many technologies come with some of these standards already baked in, which is a good thing. Think about components. Anne talked about boiling the ocean. I often say you don't have to buy everything at once. It's almost the same thing in the purchasing phase where people say, I have to buy the whole system, every component of the system now, when you don't even know how to use it yet, right? Try riding the bike before you drive the Ferrari, right? Start small, scale up, think in components. Work with materials you know and understand. That's what Giuseppe did. Don't go buy a system that your technical team won't understand. Okay, buy something that makes sense for you. Think about metadata. Be planful with it. Think about how it flows through the structure, how it flows through the building. Know how the materials flow through the building and know what the assets, know what assets they take with them after they go. Because one thing that's super important that there's more and more emphasis on today is what happens to our assets when they leave the system. That's just as important as what happens to them when they're in the system. So the principles of embedded metadata, when something goes beyond the system, when it ends up on a mobile device or it ends up on a website, are you optimizing it for search? Are you optimizing it for personalization? Is that metadata traveling with the asset as it goes throughout its journey? Buy components that fit together and are interoperable. It's really interesting that a year and a half ago, I would say half the DAM vendors, maybe three quarters of the digital asset management vendors that we evaluated as a company at Real Story Group did not have APIs at all. They had very, very little integration capabilities, but by now, almost all of them do. Now, not all APIs are created equal, different levels of capability. Generally, the organizations that have had APIs and the vendors that have APIs longer tend to have richer ones. But these days, you can buy DAMs that are highly interoperable and that have components that can work together and that you can also work with to integrate with what you need. Plan for growth. Plan for scale. This is one of the most amazing apartment buildings I've ever seen anywhere in the world. It's in Hong Kong. It's absolutely gigantic. And this made me think about multi-tenant structures. in DAM and in our cloud-based solutions, which is going to be the last thing I'm going to touch on, is cloud and the importance of cloud in the infrastructures that we're building. So thinking about how do I plan for scale, how do I plan for growth? These days, we're building castles in the sky, in clouds. And this has been a huge, huge pendulum shift, even really just in the last 18 months. It's not that there haven't been cloud dams. There's been a lot of cloud dams for a long time. But I would say, in my experience, and RSG mostly works with very large organizations. Most large organizations didn't want to talk about the cloud a year and a half ago or 2 years ago, and now they all want to talk about the cloud. Just last night, I was talking with three Fortune 50 companies who are all talking about either their dam that's already in the cloud or moving to the cloud in the next couple of years. So we recently did a survey, Real Story Group, where we surveyed close to 200 organizations. And this is, today, 58% of the organizations said, well, our dam is mostly on-premise, but in the future, only 24% plan to keep them on-premise. And look at everyone moving towards the cloud. They're moving in that direction. And that's not just because of organizational burden, it's also because of scalability. It's also because of elasticity. It's also because they have more and more users and more of a global environment, and it makes sense. It makes sense. Here's a cloudability spectrum, okay? And this is really about historically where these particular technologies have been implemented in the cloud or not. That's not to say that they're not all cloudable, because they are, right? They're all, you could implement them all in the cloud if you wanted to. But historically, this is where vendors have been in terms of their position on the cloud. So ones that are very, very far to the right, they're either 100% SaaS or cloud-oriented dams, whereas the ones on the right have historically been on-premise, implemented on-premise. But lately, you hear all the vendors over here talking about their new cloud solutions, right? Whether they are simplified versions of their very hefty enterprise on-prem solutions, or they are working with third-party integrators who have a hosted version of their particular solution, or they are partnering with Azure, Amazon, whatever it might be, to do their own cloud version of their DAM. So this is a very, very interesting development in our industry, and you should be thinking about it, if you're not already, building castles in the clouds. So to sum up, just talk about foundations. Have a blueprint, have a clear direction and strategy of where you want to go. Build a framework with strong, durable, and standard materials. Make sure, like Giuseppe, you work with the materials you know and you understand. Be planful with content structure and with metadata. Seek the expertise that you may not have. Know how the pipes and the information and the people and the users and the workflow goes through the building. Listen to your engineers. It'll keep your system from crashing. It'll keep your house from coming down. Let the future inform the present rather than the past. Innovation takes risk. Get on the boat, cross the ocean. Don't be unrealistic, but be sure to dream big. This is what the sunrise looks like from that wall that Giuseppe built in 1954. It's there, and his family can still enjoy it, because of the strong strategy that he put in place, because of the foundation he built, because he cared so much about what was going inside. And with that, I'll simply say, thank you, Grandpa. Thank you, Grandma.